Yep, sure is. Okay, good. Everybody, welcome back to Elevating the Genre. We are your co-hosts, Christopher Morrison and
Dominic. Hi.
Hey, and we're here to talk about all.
It's not my last name's not hi. My name's Dominic. just to clarify, I'm not.
I would like to.
I could be named Dominic. Hi. I was saying Dominic, comma hi.
Yes, we could rebrand you as Dominic High, and you might have an interesting new crowd there.
I might be a different kind of high later, but. Moving on.
Dominic wrecked the intro for fuck's sake on episode three. But that's all right. Fine. We're your co-hosts. You're here to talk about all things that make smart geeky stuff actually smart. And today we're going to talk about something super dear to my heart for sure, which is The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, but also the creator of that, Douglas Adams, in general. But first, we always start with our segment, what we call What's Elevating Our Genre, where we sort of try to turn you guys on to what Dominic and I happen to be sort of into this week. That's certainly cool or whatever's geeking us out in our wonderful geeky world. So what's elevating your genre this week, Dom?
Well, I have some thoughts on Luke Cage, but I have this feeling you were going to talk about Luke Cage. If that's not the case.
We talked about it a little bit last week, but we can talk even more now that we've actually seen the fucking thing.
Right. Well, I haven't seen the whole fucking thing.
I haven't seen the whole fucking thing yet. I'm too shy. I'm on 11 or whatever.
Okay. I started watching Luke Cage. I've watched about 6 episodes of it. The main thing I think is interesting from an elevating genre perspective is how they're sort of battling the 70s legacy of their own character. You've noticed this?
Interesting. Okay.
You know what I mean?
I don't know. The only thing I can reference that I can think of off the top of my head when you say that is, like, they are working in the taglines. What do you call those? The catchphrases a little bit. Mm-hmm. Sweet Christmas shows up. Sweet Sister shows up. And they're definitely playing with that. Is that what you mean? What else do you mean?
That is what I mean. I mean, there's this sense that, they're trying to be a very, forward thinking, modern of African-American issues of this time. And also with many call outs to history. But the funny thing about, Luke Cage was born out of a time of black exploitation was a genre. That look was a genre. It was a culture. Right. It's the chains, the language they used.
Yep.
And so the great thing about comic book characters, again, is he was that, and now he's this.
Right.
The TV show has to fuse those things. And little things like he throws on the old costume at one point, and I think he says something like, this is stupid.
This looks ridiculous. Yeah, I look ridiculous or something. Yeah.
Right. There's a certain, pushing back against...
Yeah.
While also referencing the the old material, because you don't and I observe this on the ground at costume conventions when people do classic Luke Cage and cosplay.
Interesting.
There's a weird area for black men. They want to do the costume, but they don't want to be asked to pose or say Sweet Christmas or
interesting
do something to So they're
dumb it down. Literally dumb it down a little bit. Like take its base. Like I don't know if it's base to be like running around saying Sweet Christmas. But like I don't know. I mean that is interesting. I mean like the it's funny because I feel like blaxploitation in general right now is in a bit not necessarily in a resurgence, but like I think people certainly really understand its place in film history and like really understand its place in cinema history and are like pretty okay with it. I mean, and most, I think you can squarely lay that at the feet of Quentin Tarantino. I mean, there's no doubt
about that. Totally.
And so it's interesting to me. I mean, like I'm not a big cosplayer and I haven't been to a con in forever and a half. So it is really interesting to me to hear that like people seem reticent to engage with that stuff, because I would think, like, if there's any time, right now would be fucking a badass time to, like, run around and feel like you were a blaxploitation character. That seems pretty accepted, but maybe, again, No,
it's not across the board. Some people are going full blaxploitation fabulous with it. Mm. But for some people, it's a point of contention. It's just a case-by-case thing.
Sure.
And I think in the case of Luke Cage, the show, I think they're taking a more... I thought there would be more of the throwback kind of feel to it.
Interesting. Okay,
I thought there would be more of that. I think they're taking a slightly oppositional view to it in the name of going forward. And I think that's really interesting. But again, I've watched half of this shit.
Right.
But it comes up for all superheroes who have long histories, you know.
Right.
Captain America, new Captain America, all the different incarnations. So anyway.
Right, true. I mean, I would say, having watched 11 episodes of 13, and now that you're pointing it out, I think it's a great observation, and I think you're right. The thing where it seems to even out for me a lot is in the music. I mean, the music is, except when they're breaking it and, like, going straight for, like, 90s Wu-Tang or early 2000s Wu-Tang or whatever. I mean, you've got the Delphonics. I mean, I don't know if you've reached the Delphonics part of the episodes. I mean, they show up for, and they settle in for a couple episodes. And just in general, like, all the incidental music, I think, in between, even from episode one on, because what was funny was I was expecting a little bit, I was expecting from the title music, I'm a big fan of scores and all that kind of stuff. And I was expecting a much more heavy sort of bass line, wah-wah pedal, full-on blaxploitation, like Superfly kind of, like, you know, some African-American male singing in falsetto theme song. And what's funny is they did that, but they did the weird, I mean, for me, and I'm not an expert on blaxploitation films by any stretch of the imagination, the theme song is almost like a weird incidental piece of music from Superfly, like when he's like kind of walking down the street, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's not like the theme song from Superfly or anything like that. So I don't know.
Yeah.
It's interesting. You're right. I think they are, like, they're definitely in conversation with it. I mean, that's 110% true.
Yeah.
As is the look of, like, Luke Cage, because I don't know if you've actually bothered to watch episode two when for those who maybe haven't, we do a YouTube and we obviously do this, we also release this on iTunes and all that stuff, so if you want to check out the YouTube channel, do that. The link will be in the show notes, but Dom flashed some amazing action figures, and then we had a Skype problem, and I had to sort of find some stuff to cover when we were frozen, and so I picked up a bunch of action figure pictures and just sort of covered it. But researching the Luke Cage action figure, it is an interesting costume history with him too, right? Like, I mean, the costume that I'd picked up, because I had dropped comics for a while and then picked up the Avengers when Luke Cage, you know, became an Avengers, whenever the fuck that was, I don't remember, when Brian Michael Bendis was doing stuff. And they just sort of went with, like, the soft skull cap, beanie, black t-shirt, not a big chain, maybe like one, like a gold, maybe a light gold chain, and just pants, and like, and a little bit of, and a hoodie showed up once in a while. But, like, the action figure versions are like the slightly racist version of that. Like
oh, you mean the crazy colorful ones?
Yeah, like they've got, or he's like, got like big gold chains, like, and like his, I don't know, slightly disturbing in a lot of the action figures. So I try to avoid those. So it's interesting.
I'm sorry, I don't know if that's funny or not. It's kind of funny.
It is a little funny, because I mean, I think it's,
because those action figures, they're just like, the chains, the boobs,
right?
All the pouches.
Exactly right. They're crazy. So anyway,
every possible impractical appendage that we could have, let's put it on the action figure.
Yeah, and also I like the idea that for some reason there's a line of Luke Cage action figures where he's holding a bent steel girder. I just thought was a weird little thing to put in his hand. But anyway, if you're
doing that all the time.
I definitely agree that there's a huge conversation going on inside the show itself with the history of the character, and it is, it'll be interesting to feel like at the end of the series if they come down on sort of one side or another. I can tell you the catchphrases go all the way through so far. I mean, at least they're not doing them like true catchphrases. They don't show up every single show. And incredibly minor spoiler for Luke Cage, what you talking about, Willis shows up as well in the mouth of a character.
Much of the delight, I'm delighted to be spoiled on that.
On that one.
Now I have something to really look forward
to. Really look forward to. Check it out and see which character drops it, which is also interesting. So they know it, obviously. Chio, what's his bucket, knows exactly what he's doing. Sorry, I don't know his full name. That's an interesting conversation. Cool. I guess we're talking about sort of my side of elevating the genre is also a bit of a sort of a social angle as well. I just finished reading Sherry S. Tepper's Gate to Women's Country, which is don't have my glasses for the tiny text. 89. Novel. If you don't know who Sherry S. Tepper is, she's kind of renowned for being a feminist science fiction author, particularly in the 80s and the 90s, of that bent. And what I didn't know, what I'm starting to learn, is there was a big trend in sort of second wave feminism for feminist science fiction authors, and she was sort of in the middle of all that, which is cool. And I am currently trying to read more female science fiction authors in general, just because it's a big hole in my geekdom. And I'd like Sherry S. Tepper. I'd read Grass years and years ago, where I just randomly picked it up for whatever reason. I adore her writing in terms of, like, it's at the time it was just like, oh my god, what a wonderful writer, missing all of the cultural overtones completely for whatever reason. White guy probably. But this time I sort of picked it up knowing who she was, and this book is like, you'd have to be dead to miss the implications, as it's sort of a, some people call it a feminine utopia book, which I disagree with entirely. She's very even-handed about what happens, but there is a split society. There's a warlike race of, what is clearly some version of like a nuclear war has happened. The book takes place in sort of generically somewhere between the Northwestern rainforest and Utah, and there's she doesn't pin it down or whatever, and it's like 300 years later, and there's a society that's developed where they keep all the men outside the cities, which in this weird sort of standing army thing, and all the women live inside the city called Women's Country, and the women give all the male children to the army regardless at age 5, and then by age 15 each male child gets a choice whether they want to return to Women's Country or not, and give up arms, basically. While that sort of on its surface seems really, really kind of overly simplistic, the way she spins the yarn is deeply concerned with just relationships and what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman, gender roles in society as a whole. And because it takes place sort of in post-apocalyptic whatever lands, and the women have held on to the technology, and the men have, they only allow the men up to like Bronze Age tech, because they quote unquote choose to be warriors. She's very even handed on like nobody's kind of right. And then there's a big twist at the end that I won't spoil for people, but, the women have a rather large secret that they're holding back, about why the society is structured exactly the way it's structured. Anyway, badass. Really.
Wait, can I ask a clarification question?
Please.
Based on how you explain it?
Yeah.
What are they armying against? The
other towns
in the circle around?
That's it. Huh? So other towns. Other cities. Towns. They've agreed on to have this societies where there are walled towns all over the sort of, like I said, sort of spread between the Bay Area up to Seattle and over to Utah. Mm-hmm. And this is the society they've agreed to have. Then basically, they will occasionally have wars with another town, but that have the exact same societal structure in order to sort of like allow the warlike nature of the human, but obviously embodied in the men because there are no women warriors in this culture, to sort of play out. It's interesting. Is fascinating, and it's a good read. I like it. It's also fairly quick and again, I think Tepper tells a mean story, and much, much more importantly, she creates a hell of a good character. She's great at characterization. It also buzzed my buttons because she does her own weird retelling of the Trojan women in the middle of the book as a sort of a structural bracket that runs through the book, because the book is actually technically told in flashback. but we always flash forward to the women always put up this version of, they don't call it the Trojan women in the book, they call it Iphigenia to Alice, but and it's a pretty cool, it's an interesting interpretation of the Trojan women as well, if you are big theater geeks like Dom and I are, that also may be of interest to you. Anyway, The Gate to Women's Country, Sherry S. Tepper, and sort of feminist science fiction writing in the 80s and the 90s in general is a cool place where I'm going to live for a little while, I think. Delightful. Yes. So that's what's elevating our genre. Awesome. Some Luke Cage, some Sherry S. Tepper. And now we're going to dive into some frickin' Douglas Adams and Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, I think, in specific. And, of course, I think most geeks know, if you don't know or you haven't interacted somehow, if you call yourself a geek and you somehow haven't interacted with this, I'm afraid I'm going to have to use this douchey term, this IP, because really it's an intellectual property, right? Like, it's a book, but it's so much fucking more, and not in the sort of shitty, like, world-building, crappy way that, like, Avatar is, or is going to try.
We can agree to say IP if it's we're not just saying thing.
Thank you.
I get that.
Yeah.
IP, yes. It's a hell of an IP.
It's a hell of an IP, and it spans decades and media, again, before almost anything else really did in another douchey sort of term that some people don't like, the transmedia kind of way. Again, not that it was ever intended to be any of this, but it sort of turned out to that way. Anywho, so real quick, if you haven't interacted with it, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, written by a British dude named Douglas Adams, who actually has his history in comedy, in live comedy, even worked with the Pythons early on, was a script editor on Doctor Who for a season when Tom Baker was the Doctor as well. Starts out as a BBC radio drama, which is maybe super foreign to our American listeners or whatevers, or watchers or whatever, our audience. Yeah, BBC was still doing radio dramas back in the 70s and the 60s and the 80s. It never went away in England. And then became a book, and that's where it became a breakout sort of bestseller, although the radio drama did incredibly well for the BBC as well. Anywho, and then movies and all this other shit, tie-in stuff. Okay. So that's sort of the overall IP thing. I'm curious, Dom, how did you first encounter this IP? How did you encounter first encounter?
Oh, well, I remember it very specifically. Losing the Hitchhiker's Guide virginity was the BBC TV version was playing on PBS at some point.
that was the first one? That's nice. That's
yeah, it was. I think it was at some point. Like PBS used to show, I'm not even sure it was PBS. It was one of these channels that used to show a lot of Monty Python reruns.
Probably PBS, has to be, right?
Okay, all right. So they occasionally threw these other British comedy shows that you'd also never heard of, but you're in it for the Monty Python. You're like, so I watched the Monty Python, and then this other show came on, and it's like, what the shit is this? It starts, it's like a science fiction show, but it sort of looks like Monty Python. I mean, this is, you know, I'm young. I'm not processing everything. And then I realized it was just going to be the greatest show ever. So I had to backtrack from that show and figure out, oh, my God, it's a book, too? Oh, my God, that's awesome. I like books, too.
Nice.
I can get more the book version of this. And, yeah, so I went from BBC original TV show to books to learning the whole deep dive in the whole thing with radio and learning about the histories and reading all the books and then following, you know, how it all became an empire.
Right. I'm an asshole. I asked that question. I'm not sure. I know exactly what I interacted with first, but I'm trying to remember how the hell it even got into my orbit. I think, God, I must have been still in grade school or junior high when the book landed in my lap, and by that time I was a full-on geek because I was fucking D&D by the time I was 8. And when we moved to the East Coast, because I was born in Tennessee, we'd found like a gaming group and everything else, so we were gaming and like all of those people, so it must have been talked about a lot, so I must have just picked it up because somebody had talked about it or whatever. But I do distinctly remember finishing the at the time what was the final book of the trilogy, the fourth book, Mostly Harmless. No, it wasn't Mostly Harmless. That's right. Mostly Harmless.
So Long and Thanks for All the Fish is fourth.
So Long and Thanks for All the Fish.
Most Harmless is fifth.
Fifth. Thank you.
I believe.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. So Long and Thanks for All the Fifth. And getting up and walking. I had a Garfield wall calendar in my room. Thank you very much. 12-month wall calendar. And writing down the date that... And I wrote on the calendar the day I finished the best book series of my life or something.
Really?
Yeah. Aww, totally.
That's freaking awesome.
I wonder if I still have that somewhere.
Wow.
And I just remember weeping, spoilers for fucking the end of whatever, Marvin's last moment in So Long and Thanks for All the Fish is just heartbreaking and wonderful. A message from God apologizing to the android. Come on, the message from the universe, not God, a message from the universe apologizing to this android who has literally lived, what is it, three times the amount of the universe itself by the end, which is just awesome. Oh, we got tangled problems.
Wonderful moment.
Yeah, wonderful moment. And just like, just being devastated and funny. Anyway, yeah. So yeah, no, I encountered it as a book, and then as I found theater and sort of reader's theater, I think that's how I encountered the radio series originally, was like, got a hold of the book of the radio scripts to like do in some reader's theater bullshit competition thing or whatever, and then sought out the radio drama itself, which I still think to this day is one of the funniest fucking things in the world. It's just so bloody brilliant.
Wait, I assume you mean the book Hitchhiker's Guide was the first book you
Fell to your lap. The book, yeah. And then I read the series because I was a series maniac. Like, I was a massive completionist back then. Like, if I started something, I had to start at the beginning and I had to read it in order. Like, if I found, and this was back in the day with no Amazon or whatever, if I had found, and I didn't have, I was a kid, so I didn't have a lot of money. So if I found like the fourth book in a series that I was like, oh, this looks good, I'd buy the fourth book, but I wouldn't touch it for years until I bought book 1, 2, and 3.
right,
or whatever. Cool. So yeah, cool. No. Once I got Hitchhikers, I had to go through it in order, for sure.
Completionism, completionist sign of a good geek.
It's a certain type of early skilled trait. I've since become less of that kind of geek.
Okay.
Because I think I had to once you discover comic books, and especially comic books. This is a medium that never has a third act, so it's just never going to end.
Right.
So fuck this shit. I have to stop at some point.
And then they're turning it against you by making you, you wanted to buy these 67 issues, so we'll just make them. Anyway.
And that's true.
Slight divergence.
But again, I will reference people back to our episode 1 where we talk a little bit about this. Yes, where that was definitely my issue with Marvel Comics, and that's one of the reasons I definitely...
Right.
This is what broke me, was like Marvel overusing Wolverine and trying to make me buy every comic book that he was in. Because I was down for doing that, then it just became impossible. So, fuck it. Right. Anyway, back to Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy and Douglas Adams. So,
I was going to mention, I think a lot of people came to it out of the old text-based video game.
The fucking Infocom game.
Infocom,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
I think a lot of people came to it that way, which I don't know how far you got in it. I didn't get past like 15% of the game because it was maddeningly hard. I don't know if anyone remembers how these games work. They were text-based question and answer formed games, and you had to perform actions, and... the ones in Hitchhiker's Guide, the game, were ridiculously convoluted, insane Dadaist things you had to do to get to to unlock the next achievement in the current parlance.
Yes.
You read this, right? Like,
oh yeah,
the Babel Fish. Impossible.
It was I can't remember how I actually finished the game, but I was not a good gamer.
Oh, well, good
so
for you.
I'm pretty bad. I must have cheated somehow. Because I mean, I spent so much time on it, I think I can remember how to get the Babel Fish. You have to put your ready, motherfuckers? So you're on the Vogon spaceship. I'm not even resetting this for you people. So if you don't know what I'm talking about, everybody go get a coffee or like suck on a lollipop.
No, context doesn't help. That's the point. In this game, context doesn't help.
You're on the Vogon spaceship. First of all, you're playing Arthur Dent. That's all I'm telling you. Okay, so you're playing Arthur Dent. You have a bathrobe. Your friend Ford Prefect has a bag. And you've got some shit in your pockets. That's all I'm telling you. To get the Babel Fish, you have to take Arthur Dent's bag, put it on the vent that's on the ground, you have in your pockets junk mail, put the junk mail on the bag on top of the vent, then go over and push the button for the babelfish. Because why? Because the babelfish shoots out. It doesn't just like land in the slot like it does nicely in the BBC TV show. It shoots out of the the dispenser in the air, which then triggers the Vogon cleaning system, which sends an air cleaning robot who will snatch it out of the air. But you have to have your robe ready. You have one turn. You have one like beat. Like the way these games, some of these games worked was like you had one beat to react. So you, the way the beats worked is you had a command prompt, and whatever you put in the command prompt was a beat, right? So in the command prompt, you had to take off your bathrobe and throw it over the fucking flying robot. Okay? So when you did that, the flying... Wait, am I getting this backwards? Okay, I'm pretty sure. The flying robot then...
This is epic.
Exactly. The flying robot somehow falls into the bag, sending all the junk mail up into the air, right? And dislodging the bag, the vent then releases a jet of air, sending all of the junk mail up into the air, where the other cleaning robot goes out and grabs all the junk mail out of the air and accidentally knocks it into your ear while trying to clean up all the junk mail and hits the babelfish, I think, into your ear. Something like that.
Something like that.
Ridiculousness. It was fucking ridiculous. I must have cheated somehow, or somebody must have told me or something.
So to you kids today, if you think like killing the right amount of zombies in Call of Duty is hard, fucking don't even know how hard it was to get the babelfish in the text Infocom Hitchhiker's Guide game. Because the other half of that experience, when you just explained the walkthrough, the other half of the experience is you don't know, and the babelfish slides out every fucking time.
Right?
70 times in a row. That's all it does.
It's all it does, man. And,
you're stuck there, and it's like the 75th time, and it's slid past, and there's no variation. You're like, I'm in hell.
It's really a version of purgatory. And what's amazing is that you're talking to a mod, because Douglas Adams was directly involved in the creation of that game. And then Infocom liked that game so much, and everybody was like, I guess, there's that weird power gamer version of people out there who love the impossible shit. They made another game literally just called Bureaucracy that Douglas Adams wrote, which is just a game of that shit, like impossible, and like half of it is just waiting around, and that's what I never finished. If there's a listener out there, I'm gonna post walkthroughs for both of those actually in the show notes.
Let's try to find them.
Just for shits and giggles. But yeah, no, Bureaucracy was nothing but the babelfish thing over and over and over again. Anyway, so yes, that is true. I think a lot of people came to Infocom, and again, for maybe the people who just need a little context about Infocom, find an old geek and say the word Zork to them, and then you'll probably be in the right place. The game is a bit legendary that way, for sure. One of the things that I think is amazing about Douglas Adams as a creator and this IP in general is the other cool thing about this is that the radio programs, depending on what year you buy the book, what edition you get the books, the radio scripts, the TV, what Dom had mentioned already, which is a BBC miniseries, what eventually becomes a movie as well, they're all slightly different. And it's not because of adaptation, right? Which, of course, one would expect. And the game as well, of course. It's not just that. It's that Douglas Adams was completely restless about finishing this fucking thing. Like, he was constantly revising it in not a George Lucas shitty kind of way. he's constantly been quoted as being like, he just had so many different iterations of different bits and different ideas and different whatevers. And actually the radio program was made in conjunction with another gentleman, at least the last couple of episodes were made in conjunction with another gentleman anyway. And I think Douglas Adams pretty much spuriously sort of jettisons all of that material from the book anyway, as sort of a step number one. But even if you get like Douglas Adams is famous as having a foreword in one of the American editions of Hitchhikers that you know, the American edition of Hitchhikers is different, has different material than the English version of Hitchhikers. So, and as it goes along, he just sort of relentlessly is able to, like, I don't know if he's killing his darlings or he's getting rid of shit he doesn't like, but like I said, unlike George Lucas, who seemed incapable, again, sorry, personal opinion here, sidebar, who seemed incapable of actually understanding what made his own material cool, or groovy, at least to the older generation that had interacted with it. Douglas Adams never lost sight of what made Hitchhikers great, which was sort of the frumpy shabbiness of Arthur Dent, how much of a sad sack that motherfucker is, and the wonderful blend of comedy that comes from sort of the frustration and and the ridiculousness of the situation. I don't know, I guess. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I am going to say real quick, I don't stand with anything past the BBC miniseries, to my knowledge. I mean, I stand with the entire novel series. They made that movie. I don't count that.
You don't count the movie. I'm happy.
I do not count the movie.
I'm happy the movie exists. We'll leave that for issue. Then we'll put the movie in there under issues, and we'll get to that there.
Yeah. Okay.
For sure.
And but yeah, I thought it was kind of, I thought it was a function of adapting to each genre and his actual understanding of each format of radio versus TV versus novel, and I thought, I mean, the novels are the most deeply felt to me, or the novels are what I'm most down with.
Yeah, no, I understand that. I mean, and I think a lot of people would probably agree with that. I mean, that there is something almost to me unreproducible about his prose, which, and I'm going to contradict myself in a little bit about that in a second, but in a version, because again, and this is maybe a section for the issue too, because they put out two posthumous books, one, The Salmon of Doubt, which is whatever, which is more like his, which is literally the shit they took off his hard drive after he died.
Uh-huh.
And then there was this Owen Colfer book, which I'm blanking on now, and another thing, which I dutifully got from a library and read just because, also deeply personal. This was after Jim Henson. This was the second death of a creator that wrecked me, that ruined me. I distinctly remember, I still have goosebumps, distinctly remember the day waking up and walking into my kitchen before whatever the fuck, it was school. I guess I was still in high school when he died. No, that's not, that can't possibly be true because he died in 2002.
I do not recall.
I was in my mother's kitchen. What the fuck? I must have been over Christmas or something. And opening up the paper, and not having known that he had died, but the guy that wrote, what is that fucking Fuzzy? The comic strip Fuzzy? If you guys know what that is, it's a stupid dog and a cat comic strip. But he suspended his strip and just had a picture of the Earth with the number 42 on top of it. Mm. And I opened it up and I was like, and I'm getting goosebumps right now. And I'm like, why is that there? And obviously, I'm one of these Easter egg geeks. I love them. And I'm like, okay, he's referencing Douglas Adams. Oh my God, what the fuck happened? Right? Like I just knew immediately. And then I don't even remember what source I went to. All I remember is, again, exactly what's happening right now. My hair stood up on end. I got my eyes filled with tears, and I found out that he had died from this heart attack at 49. Shit, now I just got so emotional, I completely forgot where to go with this.
That's okay. Well, you were just expressing the moment when Douglas Adams, the actual person, left the Earth.
Yes, but I was doing that in connection with what?
Fuzzy the comic?
No,
strip
before
with
that,
cats
no.
and dogs.
Cats and dogs, Fuzzy the comic series. Wow, I'm the worst.
Well, anyway,
yeah,
it's Thursday. I'm glad we're having this conversation on Thursday.
I never could quite get the hang of Thursdays.
I'm just gonna keep rambling like that until you recall what your thread was.
I don't give a shit. All right, his prose is unreproducible, right? So anyway, so they put out this fucking book and another thing written by this guy named Owen Colfer. May throw this. I'll get more thoughts on maybe this in issues, but and he does no harm to Owen Colfer. I never read any Colfer or whatever the fuck his name is. I never read any of his other books. And he almost gets it right, and that's almost what's most annoying about it. Is like he gets the sort of British sensibility about it, but like just doesn't have the turn of phrase that that motherfucker has. Right, that Douglas Adams is gifted with these crazy little, just little tweaks to the language in the right place and time. The concept, one that I always will never forget, is always, you know, the monkeys were so pleased with their digital watches, right? Like that just as a thing is like, just sums him up perfectly. Like it's just brilliant, right? Or that the it wasn't the little green pieces of paper that were overall generally unhappy,
right?
Like it's fucking like what? You know, and so that comes through, I think, very clear in the books, because you just get prose of him. You get his brain dumped around on the ground, not synthesized through an actor interpretation of dialogue or even a narrator trying to interpret his lines.
Now, as far as you know, did it go radio show, TV series, books, or radio show, books, TV series?
That way. That way. Definitely went books first.
TV series was after the
The third, after So Long and Thanks for All the Fish, I think. If I'm not mistaken.
Or maybe it was just after the first two books.
I don't know. Let's get dates. Who's on dates?
That would make more sense. I don't have my stuff geared.
You don't have your stuff geared.
It's not really that consequential to my point, except to say that.
Yeah.
Except to say that I think in the novels he started working stuff out exactly as he wanted it, you know, because he's a artist. So he got to really, you know, he just. Absent the variables of other people and other production concerns, he gets to write it exactly the way he wanted. And that's one of the delicious things about novels. That's what's nice about writing novels. Yeah. To the point of the singularity of his prose, that's not really how you use the word singularity, but
singularness.
Yeah, I think it's irreproducible, but as a person who's mainly a writer, I gave you something to aspire to.
Oh, man, yeah.
That was nice. When I was introduced to those books at a very early age, it gave me a style to try for.
Yeah.
To break down and see how it's doing there. Because, you know, like you read some canonical works and you're like, yeah, Fitzgerald, awesome. But do you actually want to write like him? Right. You know what I mean? Yeah, some people do. Yeah. I don't.
Yep.
You just like it that exists, but then you're like, oh, I want to figure out how this guy writes, and by doing that, you better yourself just by, you know, trying to break down with the masters, and you know, because it's comedy, you know, so in comedy, has certain like tricks. You go, he's always pulling out these lists. It's, you know, like the Star Trek list, A, B, and then you know, the alien from Septon 4. Lists are funny, and the melding of bar culture with alien space culture is always funny.
Always
for
funny.
Some reason.
Yes.
Just the idea of a super drink.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what kind of a schedule you're on with discussing Douglas Adams. Obviously, we do that for 17 hours.
Yep.
But I want to speak to, so apart from the distinctive comedy skills, we have to mention his work as a futurist too, because
absolutely.
He invented this thing that we're using right now.
Yeah.
Right? When he was writing, there were not iPhones.
Right.
There were not PDAs even.
Right.
The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy is this thing which is in your hand, and you look up anything that's ever happened in the universe.
Right.
And at the time, that didn't exist. That was a crazy idea.
Right. Yeah.
And he just made it up.
Yeah, and it's a combination of an e-book. It's a combination of a Kindle and a PDA. Yeah. And what's crazy is he's an early adapter. On top of it all, he's an early adapter of PDAs. I remember.
Oh, totally.
I wasn't a big internet head when it first happened, but somehow, I got to an article that I don't remember reading on an actual paper article. I read it, it might be one of the first things I ever read, quote unquote, online. about him trying out an actual, basically what would have been a what were those early PDAs called? They weren't BlackBerries. What the fuck were those?
I don't remember what the company was,
but I remember him talking about, oh, I can sit in the bath and type, right? That's
right,
his,
right,
like,
right.
With my, and he had to say, he had to figure out he couldn't use his digits. He had to figure out to hold it and use his thumbs. And the first time I ever got my hands on a BlackBerry, the
wow.
first fucking thing I thought about was like,
right.
nope, Douglas Adams says I should use my thumbs.
Right. Right. So he's like, so he's not just a comedy writer. Some people unfairly yeah. dismiss him as, oh, that's just the jokey science fiction series. In some ways, it's the most accurate futurist series we've got because it predicted absolutely. Much more than, I don't know, fucking Ringworld.
Yeah.
something we'd have in the future
yeah.
that we actually have and how it would change culture forever, and now we've actually got it.
Right.
You know, that's pretty good futurism right there, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Pretty
because,
good.
Yeah, and he's not, yeah, and that's the thing. It's because he was a futurist. He was always on the
yeah.
cutting edge. He was on the cutting edge of computer technology, you know, like or dismiss Apple for whatever it is or was. He was a super early adapter for that. He was.
Oh yeah, he loved his Apple.
he was on CompuServe early in the day. You know,
right.
he was one of the first ones to try to crowdsource some. He tried to crowdsource the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. I think it was called H2G2 on
God,
it was on
right.
CompuServe. It was like a listserv or whatever that he
right.
put out. And this was, you know, and this was in the 90s. This wasn't in like fucking whatever. Like, and this is a guy that was a, you know, this jokey science fiction writer was asked to speak at keynote speeches at technology conferences. And that's the other thing you can't also dismiss about him is that he has an activist side, particularly involving conservation and particularly conservation of animals and in general environmentalism as well. He's got a couple of other books that maybe most people don't know about. That I will freely admit, I actually haven't read sort of The Meaning of Lif and Last Chance to See. And Last Chance to See 2, I believe, which sort of details his journey traveling around the world, getting a chance
right.
to interact and literally see these incredibly endangered species, like species that are in like the double digits left on the planet and not big ones either.
But that thread is all through the original Hitchhiker's books. Always,
exactly.
Like, he's always the animals, the whale, the fish.
The fish.
Just the metaphor of humans, you know,
right.
that can be eliminated by, like ants by,
right.
you know.
And just the idea that sentience sucks, right? Like, that,
yeah.
like it's just,
yeah, yeah.
they're not nihilistic books in any way, shape, or form. He just is perfectly willing to admit how the ridiculous, you know, in a, like you said, in sort of a Dadaist way, it's just there's no escaping the ridiculousness of consciousness. There's no escaping the ridiculousness of like getting a bunch of sentient people together and how fucking hard it is to just get along. Like, no, we've got to create 18 forms that have to be signed in triplicate, lost, buried in peat moss, and you know, and
right.
rediscovered.
Right.
And you know,
right.
And that's one thing that he always was. I think any good comic is angry. I'm drawn to angry comics in general. Bill Hicks, George Carlin, and I think like any good comic, I think he's pissed off at the human condition a little bit, which is great because it's for when someone's that pissed off and can then really put their finger on it in such an interesting way that he does, and he is obsessed with sort of. The bureaucratic systems of sentient
right,
beings, right.
Right? Right?
And that's where an enormous amount of his comedy comes from.
Right.
But,
we, you know,
yeah.
we process the difficult things in life with humor, and that's kind of like
yeah.
a very basic way to do it, and he did the shit out of that.
And in an interesting and original setting, right? The idea that is going to be played out. Because a lot of people think of science fiction as like, you know, you've either got sort of space opera, which is completely devoid of all that stuff, where it's just like, you know, right and wrong, fable-ish stuff people get in, and there's lasers and there's exciting and there's action, or there's sort of evil, horrible dystopia where society is just all wrong. And you've got this little kind of tiny version of utopias, but we can talk about that some other time. But the fact that he just took it all and was like, nope, future's just going to be like right it is now. It's just going to be frustrating. It's just going to be a fucking frustrating mess, except
yeah.
it's going to be, you're going to have, you know, aliens and pangalactic gargle blasters and dudes named Zaphod Beeble Brox with two heads and three arms. And it's all ridiculous. So fuck off. You know, it's great and wonderful. And I'm going to go out on a limb here and say nobody's come close. The only thing that I can think of, the only other property I can think of it even comes close to being that funny and that well executed in a science fiction comedy sort of sense is Galaxy Quest, because I've never been able, but and that is only funny because of the context of Star Trek, to be completely honest. If Star Trek didn't exist, Galaxy Quest wouldn't be half as funny, or it wouldn't have been made, period, anyway. Like, who else has followed in this footstep that steps that, like, I remember trying to read, like, there's a guy named, if you remember the Myth Adventures series by Robert Asprin, he had some science fiction comedy stuff. There was a book called Fool's Company, I think. And it just fell so flat in comparison to, comparison to Hitchhikers, which is probably an unfair comparison. Maybe if I hadn't read it, maybe it would have been better. Oh my God, I just pulled out Fool's Company by Robert Asprin. Now I'm gonna have to link that shit because none of you know what that is. I'm sure I know. I just stop yelling at your computer screens and your phones. I know you know what it is. You're all good geeks. I apologize. but like, I can't. Can you think of anybody else that plays in sort of the science fiction comedy realm?
No, it's definitely a hole that's. I can't think of how to fill it. Delightful science fiction comedy that also has social issues, political commentary, futurists. It's not coming to the top of my brain, I don't think.
I don't know. Yeah, people, if you know, please go ahead and list in the comments, because I can't even think. Even in comics, I can't come up with anything. I mean, there's Grant Morrison has a little thing called The Filth, but that's Grant Morrison is much more interested in being filthy in that on some level, but it's very funny. It's intentionally funny, but again, it's so bleak. And that's a comic series that you can probably find. You can find in graphic novel form now. I'm just trying to think of anything else. I really can't.
Well, just at some point, they buckled down and hated genre crossing.
Right.
Right? In our lifetime.
Yes.
So things like Hitchhikers were always going to be on the hit lists, even though they were the best. So I've laughed more at a Louis C.K. special.
Oh, sure.
I've enjoyed the science fiction more in, I don't know, something. I've enjoyed the science fiction as much in other properties.
Sure.
Never at the same time in the same city.
Right.
I'm pretty sure never.
Yeah, no, same here.
Because people hate genre crossing, god damn it.
Right, a little bit. Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about some anime, maybe something like a Dirty Pair or some bullshit, but even that is so crude. Or at least the way it got translated into English, I don't know.
Some anime, like maybe in the area of Evangelion or the adaptation of Cutie Honey. I don't know if any people like this. I mean, those pieces are sublime and they are funny and they do have science fiction space opera in them and they are completely Japanese. So I cannot speak to the subtleties of the text.
Right.
So I'm not even going to try to say,
what
like,
was that
whether
second
that's
one?
A good comparison.
I know I've heard of Evangelion. I don't know the other one. What did you say?
Oh, Evangelion.
Evangelion.
Okay,
what was
so,
the second? What's the second? What was the other one, though? You said two
it's
things.
The live action adaptation of Cutie Honey. Cutie Honey is, not as popular series here in the States, but, it's well known in Japan.
Okay.
And the director of the Evangelion series directed the live-action adaptation of Cutie Honey, which made it just, like, a lot... Speaking of elevated genre, it made it a lot more than it needed to be. Basically, Cutie Honey is a really cute android, sort of skippy outfits, hot girl type, and she has some powers.
Okay.
And people remember her affectionately. Japanese people... She goes, Honey Flash! And changes into superhero.
Gotcha.
The theme song is good, and the live action adaptation is just way funnier and more interesting than it has any need to be.
Oh, okay, cool.
So that's why I thought of that.
All right.
All
right. So there's maybe something to steer people towards. Because other than that, I just can't think of anything that merges it. That's not right either. All right. No. Fuck it. All right. Yep. Moving on from that, I guess. Yeah, because that is just one of the things that makes him special. That really talk about elevating the genre, the intersection of the science fiction, the humor, the social aspect of it, the never afraid to go dark, ever, never, ever afraid to go dark. never afraid to, you know, it's like good peanuts, right? Good Charles M. Schulz peanuts. Like, Schulz was never afraid to, like, put Charlie Brown through the fucking ringer, mm-hmm. because that's what makes mm-hmm. you associate with him, because we've all been there. Mm-hmm. And Arthur Dent just relentlessly gets to be a sad sack. He gets to win once in a while, but, you know, just it's not going to last for very long, and he's going to just
right.
be lost and out of his element in the very next time. Oh, you know what? Okay, lower hitting Red Dwarf kind of does some stuff. It's got some.
I haven't watched enough to know, but sometimes it's very good.
It punches super low on occasion, very low on occasion. Right. It's really ridiculously silly, and that's also getting a new season actually very soon, I think. Actually, But anyway, I found that very funny. Although, yeah, no, it has no prediction of the future. No, it's just it punches super super low, and right. doesn't. I mean. It doesn't elevate the genre at all outside of the fact that, hey, at least they were brave enough to put comedy and science fiction side by side.
Right.
And throw in dick jokes, I guess. I guess that's semi-brave. Yeah. Anywho. Yeah. All right. So, I guess let's, I think we're ready to move into our issues. Let's talk about some issues. So I am interested in your, stuff that you are, I'm interested in your feeling on the movie. Yeah, because you mentioned that you were not a fan.
Oh,
and sorry,
I'm talking about the live action, I believe, American based movie with Zooey Deschanel.
Wait,
Most Def, I believe, was
Most Def was for Prefects, and so, Sam Rockwell as Zaphod.
Very interesting, eclectic cat. I mean, okay, and not bearing the lead, the movie was terrible. Okay, backtracking. Okay. Part of the thing of becoming a Hitchhiker's fan, I think most of us would agree here in the States, is adapting to British humor style, certain ineffable things that are more in Britishisms than here. I thought the movie was a terribly good illustration of that not happening very well. Mm-hmm. The movie is eclectic as hell,
yes,
without really being truly interesting.
Okay.
I thought Alan Rickman's performance as Marvin really nicely illustrated the difference between miserable and depressing. If that makes any sense. It's a very subtle thing of voice performance, but contrast BBC old Marvin TV series with the movie. I'm not sure which goes. Listening to Alan Rickman as Marvin is just depressing.
Okay.
He just, maybe only depressive people will totally understand what I'm saying.
Okay.
It's just depressing. He just sounds like a guy who wants to kill himself and you don't want him in the room. The guy who did the old BBC series sounded like just miserable. But he wasn't depressing. Okay. He was the guy who just had a miserable outlook on life.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's the difference between, you know, active and inactive or whatever, just paralyzing and non-paralyzing.
Interesting.
So little things like, I couldn't take that Marvin. I couldn't take it. Although I love Alan Rickman.
God rest.
I think he was just going for a different coloring of it that... Oh, God, this movie's so wrong. I mean, it's just not funny in the same way. Mm. People are just not, the beats, the rhythm of it, it just would never translate. I mean, it would have to be a BBC series again. It just would, it just terminally unable to translate into our American movie idiom, definitely. Sure. American feature film idiom, forget. Okay. Netflix series, do it, Netflix.
That would be nice.
Make a new Hitchhiker's movie.
Okay, so we're going to have a first major fight, Dom. I'm very excited about it.
All right.
Now, okay. Again, everybody stop yelling at your phones. I'm not going to defend the movie. I don't love the movie. I don't love it. It's fine. However, when I find myself watching it more than I ever thought I would. Number one, I think it was because it hit at the right time for me. When I did my research on people making it happen, the fact that his death sort of pushed it over the top and made it happen, I felt like the people who were trying were had their hearts in the right place. And it was, and I rarely do this, certainly anymore, but, and I rarely did it back then either, which is, like, I actually followed the production once it was announced and, like, whatever, and, like, was like, how is this happening? Because as any big fan of this IP knows, this movie's pretty much been in and out of, was in and out of development from 1986 or something like that.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And famously, also, if you read up on Douglas, he had something like 86 different drafts on his computer from that time to when this movie finally got dropped, including apparently a script, which I wish I could get my hands on, where the Vogons are the main characters. which sounds crazy pants, and I don't even know why he took it in that direction at some point, but I really wish I could read that script. Which also I think probably accounts for like the eclectic nature of this script, because I think it was put together later by whoever the writers, some Kirkpatrick person, and I think it was an eclectic version of a bunch of these different scripts, and that's also why it feels crazy, I think. And I agree, it is super disjointed. It almost feels like it feels much more like a TV show. If it would feel better in episodes. I am not a fan, so I'll start off with what I'm not a fan of. I'm not a fan of Zooey Deschanel's performance in this. Zooey Deschanel in general is fine for me. I think she's a fairly awful Trillian, and I also think that character gets a weird short shrift in that version, being sort of like trying to make her the Arthur Dent. What was great about the Arthur Dent Trillian relationship in the books and everything else is that Arthur Dent thinks he's in a trying to create a love triangle, but Trillian never seems to perceive that way at all.
Yes.
So the fact that then Trillian, that's what that becomes about, and it becomes this sort of American movie love story thing, changes the tone exactly the way you said, changes the tone in a pretty horrible way that just doesn't work. I have a genetic problem. Sam Rockwell makes me happy. I don't know why. it feels like it's a gene problem, because like I will watch Sam Rockwell in like a shitty fucking movie like Choke and actually be happy the whole time. I don't know why, but that motherfucker just like does no wrong for me. I don't know why.
You're allowed to like the movie if you have a genetic problem. I mean
exactly.
Can say
right.
to that.
So Sam Rockwell saves it for me. Although again, I hate what I really don't know why in this day and age they couldn't actually have a double-headed Sam Rockwell, because I was really looking forward to that, and then sort of hiding the head in his neck was dumb. But I love his fucking delivery of Zaphod. I think his interpretation of Zaphod is brilliant. Not that Mark Wing Davey, who is portraying Zaphod in the BBC series, is also not brilliant, because he's fucking great and the outfit in that is great. It's just the technology of the time with the head is so bad, and they all know it, and that's fine, but whatever, who cares. And I love the fact that they brought back the book and Simon Jones reading the book for the feature film, which is actually a through line that goes all the way back to the radio the radio series. And then that they use the same similar animation style from what they used in the TV series, because some of that stuff is some of the best stuff that plays in the movie as well. Martin Freeman as Arthur Dent, I'm up and down on, just because what's his bucket, who plays him in the audio drama and in the the BBC version is so fucking good. Simon Jones,
whoever that guy is,
and is Arthur. Arthur's his name, and I can't remember what his name is. Anyway, he's great. And there was sort of a fervor about Mos Def as Ford Prefect. I thought he actually acquitted himself pretty well. I was surprised.
That was cool. I was into that.
It was cool, and his interpretation was kind of great. I don't know, particularly from him and Sam Rockwell, I just felt like they were having so much fucking fun. And I really felt like, I don't know if Sam Rockwell was a fan, but it really felt like Mos Def was somehow, I don't know why, this is all in my fucking head, right? That he was just having a really good time. And then this is also when I really discovered Bill Nighy. If everybody remembers, this is 2005, I think, when this movie comes out. And Bill Nighy appears in fucking everything all of a sudden, pretty much around this time. And he's playing... He's playing Slarty Bartfast.
Oh, he was Slarty Bartfast. Okay.
Yeah.
Bill Nighy. Okay.
And he's so quintessentially British, and that's so great. Yeah. And since his scenes are with another Brit, with Martin Freeman,
Yeah.
That stuff feels very British to me. And that stuff feels like in the right rhythm and in the right tone and everything else. And just the way fucking Bill Nighy delivers a bunch of his lines are just, instead it didn't matter. And like, and just, you know, he has that Bill Nighy head, he was a, lip was, pursing thing.
Was he the old guy, dude in Love Actually too?
Yes, of course. Yeah, he plays the rock and roll guy in Love Actually.
Right. Okay.
And the dad in Shaun of the Dead, and like he appears in everything around this time. This is where at least maybe gets really on Hollywood's radar around this. So I love his interpretation of Slaughter Bar Fast as well. Yeah, I didn't like Marvin either. I love Alan Rickman. I didn't really I didn't really like the design of that one. I was really glad. I guess it's not a spoiler for this movie, but there is, for those that don't know, there the old Marvin does make an appearance in the movie. The BBC Marvin is in the movie. Find him. Enjoy that a little Easter egg hunt. But yes, no, it feels super disjointed and it doesn't hold together and it's not great. The only thing that happens, though, is every time I watch it, one of the reasons I watch it is just for the ending and the stupid Heart of Gold. They have the stupid joke where the other end of the universe and the Heart of Gold goes across the screen. And then the Heart of Gold turns into a bunch of different things and they engage the impossibility drive. And then the ending scene, the ending thing it turns into is a big thing of Douglas Adams' face that sort of just sort of drifts towards the screen.
I didn't even remember that.
It's because I've seen it a bunch of times.
I've seen it only like 1.5 times.
I am such a sucker for this IP. I'm such a sucker for anything that Douglas Adams actually had his fucking hands on, but I'll take it, man. I have the DVD over there. I'll throw it in once in a while, just to give myself the little fix. No, I have the BBC. BBC TV series as well, of course.
I watch those a lot on repeat. I don't watch the movie. But anyway, okay, yeah. But here, I want to add something.
Please.
Like, they should have done the movie of Life, Universe, and Everything. That's something America could have done.
Right.
Because
that is true.
What most people are a lot of people are just familiar with the first two books, Hitchhiker's Guide and Restaurant, at the End of the Universe, because they sort of comprise the TV series, right? The BBC series.
Right.
And I would say that in the third, fourth, and fifth Hitchhiker's books, definitely, I think there are signs of Adams gets a little more sentimental. Mm. He starts doing romance and also just more conventional science fiction tropes. He's worked out these other things. He's going for, he's just going for to try to hit all the buttons.
Right.
And so Life, Universe, Everything remembers a more classic team goes up against alien threat story. And I think that's the one they should have made a movie of.
Mm. Yeah, makes sense. That makes sense. Yeah, just sort of do a first act where the Vogons destroy the Earth and then jump right into that. That's not a bad idea. Yeah, it's interesting.
Well, I mean, I know, I just, you can't, I don't think those first two books lend themselves to a feature film-length narrative at all.
Right, yeah.
It's never gonna, it will be a great streaming series someday, God willing.
God willing,
but
yes.
Life, the Universe, and Everything, I think, could be one movie or two movies. You know, I think it has a more coherent ABC kind of
right.
Here's some weirdos. Here's a weird,
a really
here's
weird.
Here's a weird
threat.
Ship powered by a restaurant, and here's some psychotic robots.
Right, there you go.
Great.
And let's a thing, fight, and a thing, and know? A thing, and a thing. Literally out with a vengeance, vendetta against the last human. Well, sort of the quote unquote last human.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. Right. An action scene. Basically, that was the most action packed one.
Yeah, that's true.
If I'm remembering correctly.
A little bit. Yeah. I mean, there's just spoilers for the books, but yeah, it's basically all of this is powered by Arthur Dent somehow goes through. Because the other thing is a lot of people forget is there's a lot of time travel in this book because because they keep going forward and backwards with different spaceships and improbability drives and whatever. And like I said, Marvin ends up literally being three times as old as the universe because he gets shafted so many times. Somehow Arthur Dent is moving through the universe and has accidentally, or maybe in terms of fate, has been pinned on murdering this one creature that keeps reincarnating itself only to be killed by Arthur Dent over and over and over and over and over again. because Arthur Dent also is like half as old as the universe by the end of the books. And so this creature gets and obviously wants that to stop, and somehow eventually becomes sentient and realizes he's being murdered by this one this one creature that keeps moving through the universe to the point where it builds like a shrine, this giant enormous statue of a multi-armed Shiva of death, Arthur Dent, and illustrating the different ways that he murders this creature, either as a fly or a book. And it's fucking so funny, and it's so brilliant.
And a delightful joke on religion, remember? Like, yes, kids, reincarnation is real, except you're going to be killed by the same dude every single time.
And it seems to not be real for anyone else but this one fucking poor thing.
Right. This one soul, this one poor soul, literally. Your chance of achieving higher consciousness is realizing that the same dude is killing you every single time.
Murdering you every time. Unconsciously it's... murdering. And that's the other best. That's the insult.
Right, right, right. By accident.
By accident. Just that the dude doesn't even know he's doing it. Ah, oh, it's so fun. Because sometimes he does it on purpose. Like, he's a housefly. And he murders him one time as a housefly.
Yeah.
Oh, so fucking funny. And that's what you miss. Like, the construction.
Yeah.
Douglas Adams' construction. I mean, I don't want to skip over Adams' atheism at all, because that was also a central tenet to my to my life. And I realized I accidentally let slip "God rest his soul" for Alan Rickman. And I don't want anyone to take me fucking seriously, especially in the context of a podcast with a man who was described himself as a quote unquote radical atheist, and was the first. Him and George Carlin were probably the first couple of people that twigged me to that. I was raised Roman Catholic. I'm not saying I'm an atheist because of Douglas Adams and George Carlin, but like, these were people who were influential in my life in terms of thinking in different ways anyway, and that was part of the stuff that came along with them, if you paid attention. And I think that sensibility and that sense of humor is exactly right. It's all through. It's all through the books. Like, it's a way to deal with an uncaring universe through the humor. For sure. Absolutely for sure. And we'd also be remiss to sort of really quickly try to sort of touch on, if you've missed the Dirk Gently stuff, I don't know what the zeitgeist, current zeitgeist is, but I mean, for a while, the zeitgeist was like, Dirk Gently is a he wrote two books with the same main character, I guess you could say, the first one being Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency, and the second one being The Long Dark Tea Time of the Soul. I find The Long Dark Tea Time of the Soul vastly superior to Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency. I think it just holds together better. He even admitted that Dirk Gently sort of came out of what he originally was writing another Hitchhiker's book and discovered this new character. And it feels that way to me a bit. I still find it very funny and it's great.
They're making a TV series of it. That's to come. Sorry.
They're making the second TV series of it, actually. There was one beforehand, which I actually just watched last year. Now they're making a series with Elijah Wood in it, and it's fucking being made by Max Landis, the son of John Landis, if you're a horror movie fan. And know that the director of American Werewolf in London's son is doing it, so that's interesting. And I think
that's probably how he got that job.
Yeah, well, Max Landis has got a long history now of stuff, but some of it I like and some of it I like less, but we'll see how it goes. I'm somewhat optimistic. That first Dirk Gently book is hard to adapt as well. It's super episodic. It's got the best use of a time machine ever it. Sure. The revelation about how it's used is insane and wonderful. And what's funny is in the first BBC version of the Dirk Gently stuff, they sort of just used that as like the first like couple of episodes, because it was only like six episodes long, and then they made up a bunch of shit for the other episodes, and they just totally didn't use it right. It was disappointing. So I'm anxious to see.
Now, Chris, I know I've read both of them. I don't remember what happens in Long Dark Tea Time of the Soul at all.
Really?
Can you just summarize the major points so I can...
The major points of that is that Thor shows up on Earth.
Thor, right. Thor. Okay.
And not the happy Marvel Comics version of Thor, yeah. but the, like, angry, right. blundering, constantly having an erection Thor
yeah.
from the okay. Norse myths who gets mixed up with a... a woman. Yeah, there's an act of... Yes, this is a thing that happens at Heathrow that they call an act of God, but... And Dirk Gently's the only one that's asking the question, right. which God? And then Thor shows up, and I think it's very funny. Or at least I remember it being very funny. Obviously, I'm not doing a great job of sort of summarizing everything that goes down. But anyway, yeah.
Well, see, it's got Thor in it. He was writing about Thor, too, before... any of this shit happened, so that's all you need to know.
He's awesome. So that's great. Great. Like we said, we sort of just definitely can't talk much about Meeting of Lif and Last Chance to See, but that stuff is all wrapped up in his activism work, and if you're interested in that stuff, I'd recommend it. There's also a couple of really good speeches online of him talking about that kind of stuff, and I'll link to some of that stuff on YouTube that's totally available for free on YouTube, where he's talking about some of his animal rights activism and some of his keynote speeches about technology and all of that good garbage. Yeah, cool. I think we're moving into the final thoughts, man. What else you got? What's your final wrap-up thoughts on Mr. Adams and Hitchhikers?
Final thoughts on Mr. Adams. I was gonna point out how, you know, we're both struggling with our earpieces today, and a little screw you guys to Apple for freaking still enjoy the headphones with the cords, okay? But that said, you know, those new Bluetooth earbuds, how long before we have the Babel Fish version of those?
Yeah, that would be nice.
That's another thing that Adams kind of...
There's actually a Babel Fish thing for your ear. The translating guy. Have you seen the little thing? There's a translator earbud thing. Yeah, that exists. I have no idea how good it is. Okay. There is a translator earbud that is out. And floating around my Facebook page for whatever some stupid reason.
And it has no cord, right?
And it has no cord.
No cord, which is the whole point of this, to not have cords ever. Yes. Anyway, that's all. I don't know. Douglas Adams came up with everything. Okay, that's my final thought.
Yes.
He came up with smartphones. He came up with Google. He came up with everything.
Yes, he did. Great. My final thought is he's unbelievably influential to me and to my sense of humor and to what I think is... yeah, he's on a certain train of British humor that, you know, along with Monty Python and Red Dwarf and you know, to some extent Benny Hill and all of these other things that were coming over the weird PBS wire, man, at late at night on Saturdays and Sundays, I think for a lot of us, and just became absolutely seminal to my perception of what is good comedy, what is smart being, what does it mean to be smart, in a time where I was in a household that had literally a Commodore 64 until I was a sophomore in high school, in the age of the IBM clone, I was able to at least look at one of my heroes and be like, well, he thinks technology is cool. Maybe I should think technology is cool as well. And really be, like you said, a futurist, what that really meant. Yeah, just great. Can't recommend his stuff highly enough. In any form, outside of maybe the posthumous stuff that other people are writing in his name. Maybe skip that shit. And Dom really, really wants you to skip the movie. I, again, having a genetic Sam Rockwell problem, feel differently. But we discovered it's a gene problem, so that's all right. Yeah. All right. So our final little segment we always do is we let you guys know what we are working on. Again, Dom and I are very happy to be here in podcast land, and thank you for listening or watching to us. And obviously we are content creators in our own right. We always want to let you know what else we're working on. So yeah, Dom, what's going on in your world right now?
Well, the things are maintaining. I'm still writing at Yum Yum F, and I'm doing cosplay karaoke on my YouTube channel. And just did a video of Spider-Gwen and Gwen Stefani singing, Spider-Gwen and Gwen Stacy / Gwen Stefani singing Just a Girl. And I think that one came out pretty good. So try to find Just a Girl by Spider-Gwen on YouTube somewhere. And I did that. And I think it's cute. And also, oddly, there's a Gwen Stefani concert this week. And it was Gwen Stefani's birthday, so it's basically a mess of all those things. But since we're talking about this thing, I'll also take the time to say I'm also writing a novella, a science fiction, comedic, romantic novella, which in its best possible scenario will be just a little bit like a Douglas Adams thing.
Nice, dude. Oh, no, that's just great. Cool. Yeah, definitely keep us up to date on that. Love to, yeah, hopefully we can get it out to people. That's awesome. Good. Didn't know you were a prose writer. See, we learn things about each other. Very exciting. Cool. Yeah, I'm on the literally dead in the middle of the social media push, not just for the podcast, but for the movie that I keep teasing you guys that I'm working on called Joanne, which is awesome. So that's really the main thing I'm learning about and doing this week is this crazy cross-platform social media, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram push to let people know that the movie's coming, well, that the movie is going to exist. Sorry, we shoot in January here in Brussels. and it's an elevated genre film, and that's cool, and you can find that. I'll put links to where you can find it, but if you guys like us here at Elevating the Genre, hopefully you'd like Joanne the movie over at Facebook and Twitter. And for those that really maybe don't realize the state of art being an artist these days, it really is, if you're not in a studio system or if you're not in some kind of already super successful in whatever you're doing, you have to be a huckster. You have to, like, Dom and I can't tell you how much we appreciate just clicking the stupid like button, just clicking if you leave a review on anything. It's not just that we like it. It means something to our careers. And I know it sounds absolutely fucking absurd to normal people, and I'm glad most people don't have to worry about this stuff. But it means something. And it not only does it mean something to us, but we're in a world now where artists are being asked, how many likes do you have? Does this thing have a thing? It's a quantifiable thing for the business end of the artistic world. So please do know, just moving through your life, you know, if you have artist friends or you just really appreciate whatever artist, whoever it is, when you hit that like button, you are actually assisting the career of that person. So
absolutely. Yeah. Seconding that very strongly.
Yeah.
Comment, like, subscribe, or subscribe, like, comment, whatever you already do. We will love you.
Yeah.
It really matters. It helps us.
Absolutely.
If you want to help us, comment, like, subscribe.
Comment, like, subscribe, baby. Awesome. So again, yep, and do that for us here at Elevating the Genre. However you do that, you can subscribe to the YouTube channel. You can subscribe to the thing on Thingamabobber on iTunes. And if you leave a review on iTunes, it also sort of pushes us up and helps other people find us, which is great. Also for My Joanne the Movie, and also for Cosplay Karaoke, and all that good stuff. So cool. That's it for us this week. Dom and
just really quick, I want to say, it's great to hear these teasing elements about your movie. It's just to hear a little bit more about it now.
Yes, now that it's a thing and we can talk about it a little bit more.
Sounds good stuff. Right, totally.
Appreciate it. Great. Dom and I completely failed. I failed again as a host to discuss with Dom about what we were going to talk about next week. So we don't know what that's going to be. I'm sorry.
Could be any number of things.
Any number of things, but it will be cool, it will be geeky, it will be smart, I promise, and we'll try to be smart. We are Elevating the Genre. I'm Christopher.
I'm Dominic.
Sweet. And we will see you guys next time. Ciao.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
No, you're bringing back to here, Babelfish. It's all related. That's all I'm saying.